welcome. My name is Cam Kidd, and today I will be presenting a strategic analysis of the FedEx Corporation. To begin with, we will have our presentation overview, starting with the external analysis, asking the question, where are we now? This will analyze the external environment of FedEx. The inside FedEx section will consist of a financial analysis, SWOT analysis, and value chain analysis to break down the internal structure of FedEx. The Where Do We Go section consists of the 7S model and the Vero analysis. In the 7S, we are going to analyze the company and see how well its current position fits the strategy. In the Vero analysis, we will take a look at the resources and capabilities of FedEx. In the How Do We Get There section, we will be giving recommendations for both the external and internal based off the results of this analysis. So to start us off, we will have a brief history. So FedEx was founded in 1973 by Fred Smith. It was actually born out of a college paper that he had to write. And now today it is the third largest transportation company next to UPS and DHL. It reported revenues last year of $65.5 billion. It has four main business units. They're ground, express, freight, and service. And it has the nation's largest privately owned logistics network. So, to begin with the general environment, we'll be using a pastel analysis. This will help us to analyze the macroeconomic environment, help us get a view of the big picture. To start off, the political factors. So, the political factors that impact the transportation industry are things that affect the volume of shipping. Those will be things like trade policies and taxation. So in recent examples, the tariffs that the new administration, President Trump, has established on steel and aluminum has caused retaliatory tariffs by our trade partners. And if that trend continues, it will lead to a full-on trade war, and that will reduce the volume of shipping, which will have a negative impact on FedEx and the transportation industry. So the impact of the political factor is high. The economic factor, as a transportation industry, the state of the industry is directly impacted by the general state of the economy. This is due to, again, the general state of the economy determining the shipping volume. So when the economy is bad, customers are buying less, therefore companies are shipping less because they're producing less. So the economic factor impact is high. The social culture impact, as you see it there, it's invisible to people. And what I mean by this is that it's either you have a positive outreach to the community and build the name of yourself, but it'll have little effect and basically go unnoticed, or you'll be evil and you won't have outreach, and then you'll have things that are negative impacting on the social culture aspects. For example, BP. I'm sure that nobody really knew that BP was had a rig out in the Gulf until it spilled and they became an evil figure. So, the technology factor is crucial to the transportation industry because technology is what improves efficiency in operations. And improving efficiency cuts cost. So, new innovations such as blockchain and automation will help and uplift operations, making sure that companies can stay competitive. So the impact of the technological factor is high. Then the next factor would be the legal factor. And because many of these firms are multinational corporations. They have to deal with the laws of every nation that they operate in. So that will build up to be quite the extensive list. And they'll have to have a department that keeps in check that list to make sure that they are not exposing themselves to any legal risk like lawsuits and whatnot. So the legal factor is high due to the sheer volume of legal that they have to deal with. So the environment factor, in terms of when you think of environment problems, the transportation industry is not the first thing that pops into your head. Although many industry members take into account the environment and have innovations and green initiatives, because they're not under the direct light of the environmental criticism, they can avoid most of that, so the impact of the environmental factors is low. Now we will be using the five forces analysis to analyze the competitive environment in the transportation industry. So first off, we will be talking about the threat of new entrants. So the threat of new entrants is considered weak in the transportation industry because most of the major firms have invested billions of dollars into creating these logistics networks. And that and just initial investment cost is a massive barrier to entry. Bargaining power of suppliers is so that is considered weak because there is two real things that are supplied for the transportation industry, and that is materials in terms of packing and boxes and whatnot, and fuel. And in terms of the fuel, it's just market price. I mean, it's the supply is the issue, it's the cost. And in terms of materials, like packing materials, due to the number of firms that supply that type of material and the volume of sales that these transportation firms count for, the bargaining price of that supplier is weak. So, bargaining power of buyers, on the other hand, is moderate because of the nature of the industry. The few major firms all have very similar services. Therefore, they don't compete on, they do compete on a price base. So that allows the buyer to have low switching costs between the two. And whenever they're price sensitive, like they are in this industry, they just pick whatever the lowest price is. They don't have brand loyalty. So the threat of substitutes is high because, like I said, there are a few major firms and the services are basically identical. So it does not cost the buyer anything to go in between those firms because of the low differentiation. Rivalry amongst existing firms, the transportation industry is an oligopolistic market. You have a few large firms that control the majority of the market share. And that means that there is intense competition between those firms to grab as much market share in whatever way they can possibly grab. So, the next section will be the driving forces of change in the transportation industry, and these are technology, globalization, changing lifestyles, and government policy. So as previously stated, technology. The importance of emerging technologies such as drone delivery, robotic process automation, and blockchain have all huge benefits that firms could capitalize on in their operations. If they're able to effectively implement these technologies, they'll be able to increase the efficiency of their operations, therefore either being able to maintain a competitive cost or increase the profits. in terms of globalization. The importance of globalization is the increase of access in the world. So with the increasing access comes new markets, and new markets means new market shares. You have the option to move first and have the first mover advantage, or move late and be able to refine on the work of the other companies and grab the leftover demand. In terms of changing lifestyles, so we all know the growth of e-commerce. Lifestyles are changing where people want things delivered straight to them. And that means that there'll be more things that are required to be shipped. And that means that that's growth for the transportation industry. A key factor of change, like I stated before, is government policy. I can bring up the tariffs recently with Trump and the renegotiation of NAFTA, or the Brexit with Britain leaving the EU. These are all very uncertain situations where these firms have to pay attention, because they need to be able to take into consideration what the new changes are to, if it's Britain, with customs and new taxes, and the United States, it's what are these tariffs going to cost us in terms of shipping volume. So the next section is the strategic group mapping. It's a competitive analysis. So for the transportation industry, the main ones that I'm wanting to talk about to give the size and scope of each branch would be UPS, DHL, FedEx, and USPS. So the strategic group mapping here is based off of price and quality, which is on the y-axis, and geographic coverage on the x-axis. So the farther you come down along, the more that they cover internationally, and the farther they go up is the higher the quality of service. So the size of each is represented by their total revenues for the last year. So as you see, DHL abroad is making the most, and it's got the largest coverage, but has less quality than UPS and FedEx. FedEx is competing internationally and domestically with UPS and DHL, but it's still third with $65.5 billion, and UPS is the leading in the United States and is at $71.8 billion in revenue. Next is the keys to factors of success. So the first that we will discuss is economics of scale. So in terms of an oligopolistic market with only a few competitors holding all the market share, that makes room for economics of scale. This is the increase in efficiency brought on by the increase in the size of operations. So most of these companies hold massive logistic networks and operations with billions of dollars of infrastructure, and that allows them to capitalize on the gains of economies of scale. So the next key factor that we will talk about will be the geographical coverage. So something that allows for value, creates value for these firms, is that they are able to deliver to a vast number of places. For example, FedEx is able to deliver to 220 countries and territories, and having the ability to send basically anything from anywhere is one of their big success points. The speed and reliability of delivery, I will call that the effectiveness of operations. The effectiveness of their operations is important because if they're able to keep costs down, keep it efficient, the efficiency of operations, they'll be able to stay at a competitive price and or gain profits from losing cost. So then we will go from there to technology, because technology is what these firms will use to achieve that efficiency. Like I said before, blockchain, robotic process automation, I know hub facilities, both with Amazon and FedEx, use robotics to move objects that cannot be carried by the conveyor belts. FedEx has solar plants on top of their super hubs that power the majority of operations. So technology is what helps increase efficiency and keep down cost. Then company culture. Culture of a company is important because it's the people who create the experience for the customers, and it's the customers who create the profit. So, and then the last is brand image. If the customer is not aware of you, they will not seek you out to use your services. So the majority of these firms have very successful brand images. You see in the United States, FedEx and UPS on the side of their trucks every single day. I can't speak for DHL, but I know that I daily you'll see FedEx brand, and you understand that they're shipping a group, so a transportation company. So the next section will be the financial analysis of FedEx Corporation. This is where we're moving into the inside FedEx, into the internal analysis. So the first analysis in the financial is the valuation analysis. So this is showing, so the first of these ratios is the price to earnings ratio, and what that means is how much investors would have to invest to receive $1 in earnings. In company earnings. So, as you can see, FedEx is at 32, and in comparison to competitors, UPS and Blue Dart, an Indian transportation company, UPS has a 17.7 P/E ratio, and Blue Dart has a 61.8. This means that investors will have to invest the least into UPS to earn profit. So the price to sales ratio is the same, but for sales, it's the amount that investors have to invest to receive $1 of sales in from the corporation. As you can see, FedEx is at 1.0, and competitors UPS and Blue Dart, UPS is at 1.2, which is better. Then FedEx and Blue Dart is at 3.2, which is not as good. Blue Dart is also a significantly smaller firm than those two, though. So then we have the price to book ratio, which is used as a prediction tool of cash flow. UPS has a 3.4 booking ratio, while Blue Dart has a 16.8 and UPS has a 27.7. Meaning that FedEx has the better in terms of predictive cash flow. So growth analysis. The first one we're going to start off with is revenue growth. Revenue growth in FedEx has increased over the last 5 years. It had a spike last year. The year before last in 2017, but besides that, if you look at the trend, it's a steady growth. So this year was 8.51%. Competitors UPS and Blue Dart. UPS is at 79, and Blue Dart is at 7.9%, and Blue Dart is at 4.08%. So when we move on to operations income, we see that FedEx was actually a loss in operations income. This has been attributed to the surge in jet fuel price that year. And we'll get to operations margin that will show that it was not effect of there being a problem with their operations. It was an effect with their exposure to the fuel prices. In terms of operation income, competitor UPS has 2.5% and Blue Dart is at 3.56%. So it's lowest of those three, but it's not unprecedented, as seen in 2015. So the net income is at 52% for UPS, but sorry, FedEx, 52% for FedEx, and UPS is at 2.23, while Blue Dart is at 3.48. So this shows that FedEx has the largest when it comes to making actual profit. They will have earnings per share, which FedEx also leads in compared to UPS, 3.58 and 3.48. Earnings per share is the potential that share has to pay off a solid dividend. So that's good for investors. All right, we have profit margins, the first of which is the gross profit margin. This indicates the productive ability of a company compared to others. And FedEx has a gross production margin of 67%, while UPS has a gross production margin of 73%, and Blue Dart has a production margin of 9.21. So less than UPS, more than smaller firms. As understood before, this is an oligopolistic market, so only a few firms actually have vast success. Then we go to operation margins. Like stated before, we see a growth in operation margins for FedEx, even though we saw a loss in operations income in the last sheet. That was because of the fuel prices again, not because of an actual issue with the operations. The operations are still experiencing growth. It was just that the fuel risk was too high. And in terms of operations compared to competitors, they're very similar across the board. Blue Dart also has 12.323 growth, and UPS has 13.23. And in terms of net profit margin, the FedEx has about 7%, and compared to UPS, who has around 6.5%, and Blue Dart, who has 5%, they are leading in terms of actual net profit. This is the operation earnings minus the cost. So the current ratio basically represents the ability of a firm to pay off its debt with its current assets. So any number below 1 means that the firm is unable to meet its debt obligations. All industries in the category, Blue Dart, UPS, and FedEx, have met that qualification. They are above the 1.0. So the quick ratio is the ability of a firm to pay off the debt with its liquid assets, which means cash base and cash equivalents, so like account receivables and whatnot. And again, all companies are able to meet that requirement. They are above that 1.0. Now, when it comes to debt to equity ratio, FedEx is at 85.4. And this could seem high at first, but when you compare it to the industry, UPS is at 752.6, meaning that they finance most of their investments through taking on debt, and FedEx usually self-funds its own investments with its cash flow and through its investors. So closer to FedEx, Blue Dart is at 78.2. All right, then moving on to the management efficiency. Return on assets is the ability ability for a firm to take the investment that they have been given and turn that into production capability. The ROA for FedEx is about 10%, and that compares well to UPS, who's at 11%. Blue Dart actually came out on top of this category. It could be due to their small size, to where any decent growth is quite large, which is at 12.12%. So, return on equity is the return on debt assets. And for FedEx, that is 25%. But again, because UPS finances through debt, the return on equity for UPS is 238.66. So they have a better return on equity. And Blue Dart is at 30.11. So we will move on to the SWOT analysis, where we will cover the strengths, weaknesses, opportunities, and threats to the company. First off, starting with its strengths, the first strength is FedEx's culture. FedEx has always understood that culture is valuable from its first employees. So they all have had a core principle of people, service, profit, meaning that if they take care of their people, they will produce quality and excellent service, which will in turn increase profit. So, the next of FedEx's strength is brand, their brand image. So, what they're able to do with that brand is market on it and increase their sales by exposure and drawing in new customers. For FedEx, their brand is on everything they own, from their trucks to their boxes to their letters to their planes to their buildings. So that is everyday exposure. Customers will see that brand every single day. If they're able to differentiate themselves, they can be able to use that brand, build brand loyalty. Then effective operations. So the effectiveness of the operations is important and is allowed due to the vast infrastructure. I talked earlier about the trucks, buildings, and planes. Well, that is the backbone of their operations. And because FedEx owns its infrastructure, it owns its facilities, the hubs, the centers, the trucks, now the trucks and the planes, they are able to improve on that infrastructure, therefore increasing the efficiency. So, the weaknesses of the company come down to the lack of differentiation. As stated very long ago in the beginning of the industry, there are only a few firms that offer very similar services, and this lack of differentiation results in price-based competition. So, if FedEx was able to differentiate itself, it could compete on not a price basis and gain market share ahead of UPS. So, then we will look at weaknesses again with the exposure to the general state of the economy. So, as stated before, FedEx is highly exposed to the general state of the economy, meaning that it will swing with the highs and lows of the cyclical economy. Because when times are good, customers buy more, meaning that producers ship more, which means we have more clients. Then another weakness of FedEx is failed mergers, and by mergers I mean the acquisitions they make. One example is Kinko, which they acquired and turned into their FedEx office. For the first 4 years, it was negative profits and just a cost. Then more recently is the acquisition of TNT Express, which is a Dutch Express service that they have been trying to integrate with their FedEx Express. And to this day, they have been unable, for 4 years now, they have been unable to successfully integrate the two companies and are running the risk of losing key employees, unexpected cost from the attempted integration, just unnecessary risk of being exposed to. So, in terms of opportunities, the first of the opportunities I will discuss is increasing globalization, meaning that with communication technology connecting more of the world, there is access to more of the world. And that access allows for new markets, which can be capitalized on to gain more global market share when it comes available. Then the next opportunity will be the growing e-commerce, with more things becoming sold online and delivered straight to people. That's less in-store purchases where they're taking it home themselves, which means that there will be more shipping volume. Then the last of the opportunities is technological innovation. As mentioned before, it is a key success factor for firms in this industry, and FedEx uses that and understands that. One of the constant projects that they've worked on for a couple of years is improving the fuel efficiency of their air fleet, and that immediately affects costs, because like I said, they are exposed to the general jet economy, and one of those issues is exposure to the rise and fall of fuel prices. So technological innovations that improve efficiency in terms of the fuel they require is an immediate cost saver. Threats. So threats are exposure due to technology. With all these new technologies, blockchain, robotics, automation, and new online systems comes exposure. And we saw this in 2017 with the ransomware hacking going and traveling across Europe. FedEx did catch that because they had purchased TNT Express in 2016, which was hindered by a ransomware attack. And firms need to invest in security if they are planning on increasing the digital assets that they possess. And the next threat would be the volatile political environment. So with the possible trade wars, tariffs being thrown left and right, starting from the example of the steel and aluminum put up by the Trump administration, causing US trade partners to retaliate with tariffs of their own. These actions can incite trade wars and will limit shipping volume. So, then fierce competition is also an issue, because few firms, majority of the market share, are oligopolistic. In the US, there is fierce competition with UPS and FedEx. Abroad, there is DHL, who is dominant in Europe. So, to grow market share, FedEx will have to compete with these two firms at all points. All right, the next step in this presentation is the value chain analysis. So the Porter's value chain is divided into two sections, which are the primary activities down below and the secondary activities above. We will get into those in the next slide. So, this are the primary activities of the value chain. The first of which is inbound logistics. For FedEx, their inbound logistics is pickup. Their drivers will drive to their designated pickup locations. There'll be centers and whatnot to pick up shipments and packages and deliver them either to a ground center or to the airport to be taken to a hub where they'll be sorted and consolidated and then shipped out again to the destination hub where they will be unconsolidated and sent to their destinations. That is the outbound logistics. Along with this is the marking and sales, which one marking is brand, as you can see in this picture, trucks, buildings, planes, FedEx brands on everything they own. And in terms of sales, contracts are important. Long-term contracts with retail groups is important, especially as more and more established strong online presence. So several online contracts I would think of, actually one would be Amazon that FedEx has a contract with. Service, customer service, logistics, and customization. Sorry. And in terms of customer service, that is dealing with returns and issues, finding solutions for clients. And logistics, so FedEx offers logistics solutions. They will, you can go with them and they will set up a full service logistics for whatever shipment. And that is very valuable for smaller businesses that don't have the knowledge. And customization. Customization is where the value is added in delivery. You can customize it with in terms of how fast you need to get there, from 2 day to same day. You can do specific times and alternate drop-off locations. Whatever it is for customer convenience, they will attempt. So then the secondary activities. So the first of which is firm infrastructure, as we've noted several times. But the numbers for FedEx are 5,000 facilities and hubs. Those are their ground centers, that will take you to local airports, that will go to their super hubs, where everything long distance will be sorted and consolidated. Then along with that, their trucks, they have 200,000 motor vehicles and 670 airplanes. So that's a massive logistics network. And the advantages to owning that is that they can build on it and are exposed to less risk from leasing. And so next is HR management. As stated before, FedEx understands the value of its employees and understands that the good employees make good experiences. And they invest in that. FedEx has, to record, 425,000 employees. In terms of technology development, as said before, that's a key factor of success and one of the opportunities in terms of, like I said, fuel efficiency for the airplanes, the immediate cost saver. Hub automation increases efficiency, and green energy. One, it's good publicity. Two, it, in terms of long run, will save cost. So, and procurement is seeking out materials required for operations, and those are the two biggest are fuel and packaging. Fuel for trucks and planes, and packaging for the shipments to be consolidated and unconsolidated. So now we will move into the 7S framework, the organizational analysis, the first of which is strategy. So the noted strategy of the company is to compete collectively and operate individually. Like stated before, FedEx is broken down into four major business units. That is their ground and service, in which they all operate independently so that they can specialize and improve on their scope of tasks and services, but they are a united front in terms of they share clients amongst themselves to offer that full service. And the next section is structure. I guess it's talked about. It is broken up into express, ground, freight, and service. And then those are broken down by region. You'll have European Express and US Express and whatnot. Systems. Now, systems mean the operations and information in HR systems. So Cosmo is FedEx's tracking system for operations. It is what allows them to have the visibility in their network, with each package and shipment having a QR code that is scanned at every point in operation. The Cosmo system is able to tell where it is, how far along, and when it is estimated to arrive. The next is an HR system, Prism, which is their personnel tracking system, which in they, every time they have an employee, a new employee, or employee issue, it is recorded in the Prism system. Along with that, another HR system is the JCAT, which is the job change application system. So, job change application tracking system, meaning that, like I said before, FedEx is really invested in their employees, and they have a system specifically set up for employees seeking new work and jobs. So, in terms of style, as stated, this is a quote that Fred Smith picked up in his military days. It's that you feed the troops first, which means you take care of your people before yourself, and your people will work hard for you. So this has been proven in their very earliest days, whenever their pilots would use their own credit cards to buy fuel. So in terms of skills, this is the training and development of those employees. As stated before, the PSP system, the People, Service, Profit, is backed up by their training systems. They have their open door policies that allow employees to just go in and express grievances to management. They have anonymous surveying of management that allows them to give feedback on managers so that they don't feel like they have no way to communicate above their boss if they have an issue. They have tuition backing for employees seeking higher education, and they have betterment training to raise up employees, because they also have a hire from within, promote from within policy. So, in terms of staff, this is recruiting. They recruit 25,000 people on average every year. That's 6% of the company as a whole every year, so that's a decent bit of turnover and growth. So, shared values are the culture of FedEx, and the culture can be summed up by the Purple Promise, which is a promise made by every one of the employees to make every single one of FedEx's experiences exceptional. So that summarizes the mindset of the employees and leadership towards making sure that the employees are happy, so they create happy customers, which in turn creates business. So the VRO analysis, the key resources that we'll be talking about in the VRO analysis are brand equity, vast physical infrastructure, human resource management, and research and development. So with the brand equity, like I said before, FedEx's brand is a billion-dollar investment bank. So it's on every single thing they own. And it's got the potential to be a huge asset if they're able to differentiate themselves. In terms of infrastructure, they own their planes, ships, and facilities, and that is a huge advantage because, one, they have they've established themselves as a reliable network, and that is not easily imitated. So that's why the threat of new entry earlier was a weak factor. And human resources, as stated earlier, FedEx understands the value of its people, and that they are the face of the business, and that their work immediately affects the brand. And research and development, this is in terms of talking about technology, R&D, and developing new systems and technologies to improve efficiency. All right, the strategic recommendations for FedEx. For the external, we have to invest heavily in R&D because, as stated many times above, the new technologies are what increase efficiency in the operations, and that allows them to stay competitive. So, then, the next recommendation is to capitalize on the globalization, increasing globalization. And what I mean by that is the globalization creates access to previously untapped markets. And when those become available, FedEx should take that opportunity to start establishing themselves and gain that market share before they are beat out by UPS or DHL. So then being prepared for change in government policies is important. The recommendation here is to closely examine government policies and stay aware so that they can prepare for things like embargoes and trade wars and quotas that come from volatile political environments like this currently. Then we'll move on to the internal recommendations, the first of which is to increase differentiation. The value in increasing differentiation in a industry that competes on a price base due to lack of different services is that it allows them to compete on not a price base. It allows them to compete based on quality. So that will in turn allow them to charge more and or build brand loyalty, just taking market share away from its competitors. Then the next would be to invest in marketing and sales. To invest in the FedEx brand and get that out there more to change and manipulate customer mindsets. To pull them away from other firms by convincing them that FedEx is the better choice. Along with sales is to secure long-term contracts with retailers and other companies who require shipping and to use incentives like special pricing for continued service or continued usage. And then the next recommendation would be to, instead of buying companies, buy infrastructure. In the past, FedEx has bought several companies to try to integrate them into their own business, and it has been a nightmare. So what they should be doing instead is using that money to invest in infrastructure. And even if that means they won't have first mover advantage or whatnot, they can have late mover advantage and refine on what the success of their competitors has been to come in and steal the market share afterwards and be dominant for a longer time. So the final section is a test of that strategy. We three questions. Does it fit? And in terms of being aware of government policy, it protects the quality of the service in terms of protects where they're able to ship and what the cost would be. In terms of does it give them the edge, the investment in technology improves efficiency and the investment in marketing increases market share. So, and is it better? So, stopping the acquisitions that are always a struggle in investing in infrastructure will be better off in the long run because, again, they will own that infrastructure and be able to improve more and more upon it and grow steadily. So, and then here are my references.